My name is Aurora Straus. I'm a professional sports car racer. I'm not at Harvard right now. I'm skipping classes to do this, to be in LA. And I recently started a foundation called Girls with Drive, focusing on helping young girls get more involved and more engaged in male-dominated career paths. So that could be automotive, it could also be business, politics, STEM, things like that. And I'm super excited to have that continuing on into 2019, and that's pretty much what I'm up to right now. I grew up, for the most part, very separate from racing, actually. Like, my formative years had nothing to do with cars. My dad was a gearhead his whole life. He had a poster of Lamborghini Diablo above his bed, you know, ever since he was little. But I didn't grow up with that. I grew up in a tiny town called Cold Spring, New York. It's about an hour and a half north of New York City. It has one little stoplight. The entire town is like a half mile long. Most people live in town. And I barely ever drove, actually. When I was younger, I walked to and from school. I didn't have any real long-term interaction with cars. And I was into music. Like, if you had asked me 10 years ago what I thought I was going to do with my life, I would have said I'm going to go to college and I'll be an elementary school teacher and I'll be a folk singer. Okay. So big 180 there. And then when I was maybe 10 or 11 years old, my dad went in on a business kind of proposition in upstate New York in Monticello. There was an abandoned airport there, and a group of guys that he knew were talking about kind of throwing together money to put a racetrack there. And the idea is it'd be a private country club. They'd have people coming and going from New York City, but they needed someone to kind of help run the operations. So they hired my dad to help get it going. So my first time at a track was actually just looking at an abandoned airport, trying to see what sort of track it could be. And then everything was downhill or uphill, depending on your point of view from there.
Okay.
So I was there during the opening of Monticello, and then they were talking about whether or not it would be interesting to have younger drivers there, like 13 or 14-year-olds racing Miatas, and how much safer it would make them on the road. So I was the beta tester, always.
Okay.
So when I was 13, I got into a Miata. For that reason, because my dad wanted me to be a safer driver on the road. It was there. I was, you know, really into it. I thought it would be a fun way to bond with my dad, but I didn't think anything more of it. Mm-hmm. And I got behind the wheel. I almost ran into Stephen McLear's rental car. Stephen was a coach there at the time. So okay. That was really bad.
What do you mean almost? What happened there?
My dad pulled the e-brake very quickly.
Your dad pulled the e-brake?
My dad pulled the e-brake. Yep,
he was right seat
to save me. I totally would have killed his rental car. So first, you know, initial talent doesn't always mean everything.
No, not. Yeah, you got to hone it.
Yeah, exactly. So I got behind the wheel of the Mazda Miata for the first time, and I was immediately hooked. Mm-hmm. I started trying to drive as much as I possibly could. I would spend a lot of time just sitting in the car, not moving, shifting gears so I could focus on looking ahead more. I got really involved in it. And then when I was 14, my dad and I signed me up for a Skip Barber racing school in Sebring. I don't know if I'm like dating that. It was only a few years ago. I don't know if Skippy still runs schools anymore.
No, they do. They're still good.
Yeah. I know there was a period of time where they didn't. But I went to a Skip Barber racing school in Sebring. And that was my wake-up call that I just was not very good off the bat. To be fair, and I was very hard on myself as a 14-year-old who had only been driving, period, for a couple months. Mm-hmm. And everyone else there were, for the most part, you know, some of them were teenagers, but they had been in go-karts since they were 4 years old. It's a standard trope of, you know, future formula drivers.
Yeah.
And then everyone else there were adults that were just having a good time, but have been driving for decades. So I was in that awkward transition mode of trying to figure out kind of how to downshift and heel toe, things like that. And I was the slowest out of 30 students. And that was when I realized if I was really interested in this, I needed to find a way to dedicate myself to it. And that was the kind of critical moment for me of this is going to be hard because I'm not naturally good at it. I don't come from a racing family like a lot of other racers do. I'm going to have to learn how to raise my own sponsorship money if I ever decide this is something I really want to do. Mm-hmm. And is this a path I want to go down versus my elementary school folk singer path? And that was kind of when I decided that that was it for me. And this is something I wanted to do. Okay. And that's pretty much my story. From there, I started working on sponsorship proposals. I raced Mazdas for another couple of years. And then my first full year in pro racing was 2017 with the support of ModSpace Motorsports, which unfortunately the company just got acquired. But they supported me in 2017. It was pretty good for a first season. Mm-hmm. I finished fourth at Daytona, which was really fun. And then there's last year. I don't really have too much of a history, actually.
Let's go back to the 12, 13, 14-year-old Aurora.
Yep.
For a 12, 13-year-old, that's already pretty big for someone who's that young to know what they want to do, a folk singer and a teacher, and then yep. switch over to automotive. So what about getting in the car? What about that experience made you switch gears? No pun intended. That yeah. is a really, I'm going to edit that transition.
I don't know. I like it. I think part of what was so appealing to me from racing was actually how different it was. Everything in my life had been really wonderful, but also very quiet and very simple and very supported. Mm-hmm. I had the privilege of growing up with parents that have always told me I could be anything I want to be, which is not a privilege that a lot of people grow up with. You sure, know, they, yeah. when I was 5 years old, I made a joke about like, I'm going to be president one day. And they're like, sure. So that's pretty rare in of itself. And I grew up in a really progressive area of metropolitan New York. So there was very little holding me back from singing and from kind of going to good schools and working hard and doing my own thing. And racing was just fast and aggressive and scary and outside of my comfort zone. And that's part of what was appealing about it in the first place, actually. On a completely shallow level, I wanted to bond with my dad. I always felt like I was really close with my mom. And this was when I started to get much, much closer with my dad. Mm-hmm. And on a kind of deeper level, it's really empowering getting behind machinery like that, especially if you're 4'9" and you're a 13-year-old girl with like huge flowery flare jeans on. It's really cool to be able to say like, I'm behind a race car right now and I'm in charge of my own fate. I'm going into this corner it's a Miata, so not really 150, maybe 120 miles an hour.
That's fast enough.
Yeah. You're going into, you know, corner at 120 miles an hour and you small 13-year-old girl saying like, this is it. Like, this is me. I'm in control of this. I control my own destiny. And it, in a lot of ways, I likened the car to an instrument and I still do all the time. I don't have to drive a stick shift anymore just because of changing technology in cars, yeah. unfortunately.
Tragedy.
Yeah.
That's a tragedy.
But when I first learned, I was always driving stick. Mm-hmm. And my biggest obstacle in terms of getting faster was that I couldn't get myself to look up. I was always so nervous of hurting the equipment and I never knew quite when to shift. So by thinking of the car as an instrument, I actually memorized the notes at which I had to shift, like the notes at which the Miata that I was driving at that point hit redline. So third to fourth gear in the Miata when I was 13 was C sharp and I would hum a C sharp in my helmet, wait for the car to match that pitch and then shift so I wouldn't look down. Okay. So that was actually the point at which I started to get faster was during the Skippy school. And I decided to like, I actually had video in front of me and I was sitting at a piano, like clunking out keys saying, okay, this is a C sharp. This is
wow.
an E flat. That was when that was the first time I ever was really able to drop time.
Yeah. That's really interesting. So the music helped you to become a faster driver.
For sure. And it's ironic now because I'm still extremely interested and actively involved in being a musician. I mean, I'm in an a cappella group. I'm potentially going to end up in a band playing bass in the next couple of weeks. So that's still a huge part of my life, but I would never be racing if it weren't for music. There are things that you get out of racing that you would never get out of music. Music does spike your adrenaline. You know, when you go out on stage and you're looking at thousands of people who've paid money to sit there and judge you, you do kind of think twice about it. But at the same time, it's internal. It's in your control. You're working with a small group. At the end of the day, the stakes are very low. You know, if you make a mistake, the absolute worst case is you make a fool of yourself in front of a couple thousand people that you don't even know, and then you just leave. It's a bad night. Versus in racing, the stakes are you are in someone else's extremely expensive car with sponsorship money that is not your own, and it is your professional obligation to meet the expectations or surpass the expectations of those sponsors and not crash that car
sure.
and push yourself to your limit and go 100% but not 101%. that is much, much scarier. So there is a thrill-seeking aspect of that that you just don't get out of music. Mm-hmm. But there are also a lot of similarities. I think a lot of drivers think of their cars just like musicians think of their instruments. They're very passionate about their specific car, and a lot of people name their instruments. People also name their cars. You have to react to your car just like you have to react to an instrument. You don't want to do something that your car doesn't want you to do. You have to stay within your limits, just like there are limits to an instrument. To a certain extent, it stops becoming actual overlap, and it just becomes me like pushing out metaphors. But I also think it a lot of what I love about racing is what I also love about music.
Wow. Okay. Well, that I've never heard that before.
That's no one ever really thinks about it. But if you walk around the paddock and ask a bunch of random drivers or gearheads if they're musicians, most of them say yes.
Really?
Yeah, for sure. I actually a group of racers that I was teammates with in 2017 in IMSA, mm-hmm. We all had this realization at one point about halfway through the year that we were all musicians. Do you know Spencer Pompelli?
I don't, but that does sound familiar.
So I was on team with Spencer and this guy, Nick Galante, and
name sounds familiar, Nick Galante.
Oh, he lives in California, actually. That might be why.
All right.
But they both realized they both play guitars. I played bass, and one of the series officials played the drums, and we ended up playing at the end of your banquet, which was awesome. But a lot of people will either play drums or guitar. I don't really know. I think it's a soft correlation, but it's definitely there. There's something about the rhythm, about respecting the machinery, about working with other people. You know, it's more explicit in music that you need to kind of look around and respond to what other people around you are doing. And in racing, it is obviously a lot more aggressive. You know, it's every man for himself, kind of. But you need to make friends out on track. It's not sustainable for you to be out on track and have everyone around you hate you because the draft is worth so much in almost any car.
Sure.
So you need to have friends out there that are willing to help you out and who you are willing to help out if the right circumstance comes out. I think the same thing's true of music. It's a little nicer, but...
Well, I think the same thing is true with anything that you do. It's the same thing is true in business. If you make enemies in business, you're not going to get very far.
Yep, for sure.
So it's a strategic thing that you need to do. And it's very, it's very intellectual, very smart.
Yeah, I've always... my dad, at one point when I was really little, told me that a rising tide lifts all boats, which is... one of the most cliche phrases ever, but I think it's also very true that if you make enemies and you feel like you have to push other people down to lift yourself up, you hit a glass wall, a glass ceiling at some point. There's only so far that you can go without anyone else's help. And then eventually you get to that point and no one else is willing to help push you kind of through that glass ceiling.
Sure.
Versus if you have friends, it's, you know, the racing world's pretty small, but there's also room for everyone, at least right now. I mean, sports car racing is getting more popular, especially in the US all the time. NASCAR is getting less popular and sports car racing has been a lot of where those fans are ending up. So
yeah, I'm very okay with NASCAR becoming less popular. With all due respect to NASCAR, but there's only so much that you could get excited about when it's the same thing over and over and over again. When you're going around the same circle, and I guess people can argue that it's the same thing when you're talking about a track.
That's what I was just about to say. Yep.
But there's a little bit more excitement when you're going right and left than just left perpetually for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles.
Yeah, I also think it's a completely different culture. Like I would say that I'm fine with it getting less popular, but the reality is I don't really know enough about it. It's such a different world. I actually had a co-driver at Daytona who comes from the stock car racing world. Mm-hmm. And we walked by tech and he was laughing. He was like, oh my gosh, that's your tech? And it was much more sophisticated in some ways and completely elementary in other ways compared to what he's used to. But he's also not allowed to have any video from his car. So whenever we got out of the car, I think he used to race Xfinity. I'm not positive.
Okay.
But every time we got out of the car, we'd pull video and he was like, this is so nice. So it's just, I don't know enough about it to actually criticize it, but I would agree on a really base level that I'd rather watch people actually turning than people just kind of hanging out on banking for 8 hours straight.
I want to take you back a little bit, actually, to that relationship that you had with your father.
Yep.
And what you were building there when you were racing. So give me a little bit about that. You said you wanted to build a stronger relationship. You felt you were a little closer. So give me the backstory there.
Yep. My relationship with my dad, particularly as it pertains to racing, has evolved a lot over time, and particularly in the last year. Mm-hmm. When I first got started, it really was to spend more time with him. I really thought that I was not going to be a race car driver. I didn't think I was good at it. I thought it was fun, but I didn't see a future career path for myself. I also saw a lot of the instructors that worked at Monticello and how hard they work and how crazy and up and down a career path it is. I mean, you're the best race car drivers in the world still have to renew contracts every year and are still looking for work every year.
Yeah.
And that is a horrible path to deliberately put yourself on. Like every single year, my life and my career is in jeopardy. And now I'm here. But but I was looking at that and thinking, well, I'm not quite sure I want to do this, but my dad loves it. And I wasn't signing up for anything particularly crazy. I was hanging out with him in a Miata. Mm-hmm. So our relationship with racing started off as that, with, you know, him going out right seat with me. It'd be fun. We'd do club Miata races where the prize would be a big cookie instead of any sort of trophy.
Okay.
You know, he'd sit in the passenger seat and kind of laugh at people as we drove by or as they drove by us. So it started off very casual and he was very involved. He was the reason that I was racing. And it's evolved a lot. I mean, at some point a couple of years ago, when I decided I really wanted to go pro racing, he said, okay, that's great. Now learn how to build a business plan and sponsorship documents and sponsorship proposals. And I think one of the things I'm most thankful for from my parents is their business sense. Mm. I grew up with two very smart, I mean, my parents are the smartest people I know. They have business minds. They're constantly thinking about things from different creative angles. And they've been really helpful with, like, whenever I build a new sponsorship contract or meet a new person and I need advice, I immediately call both of them. And that was when my relationship with my dad transitioned from, this is a fun thing that the two of us are doing to spend time together, to, okay, if you're really serious about this, let me kind of hold your hand a little bit for the first year and see how it goes. So I, you know, dip my toes in the water in terms of writing contracts. He'd look over them and say, okay, well, you're really overvaluing yourself here. You can't ask your first sponsor for like $2 million. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the fact that your second try went immediately for, let's just say $25,000, means you really undervalued yourself.
Right.
So I learned a lot through kind of trial and error, which you have to.
We all do.
Yeah. And through asking my dad about things.
Sure.
And now our relationship is very different. He comes to races when he can. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to. He's helpful but unnecessary at the track at this point, which I think he's excited about. And it's not really me doing semi-pro or club racing anymore. It's professional racing. And I have my own separate relationships with my sponsors. He has no idea where I am most times. You know, I have to actually call my parents and track them down. I've been calling them once a day for the last few days and they finally picked up this morning. I was like, hey, just updating you. I'm in LA. I'm like, all right. So that's the relationship we have now. It's really separate and really independent, but it's nice. They're closer to my friends than they are my parents. And whenever they want to come to my races, I put them in charge of the SD cards for my video.
Okay.
And he's just track dad. You know, he hangs out, he gets all excited, he downloads a video, he uploads it to Dropbox, they'll put funny little emojis on it whenever cute things happen out on track. So he's less involved, but it's a very good thing. And it's actually enabled him to sit back. And I know he's really proud of what I've been able to build at this point and how independent I've become. So it's cool to watch him able to come to the track and just kind of sit up on the stands. And instead of sending stuff to my sponsors or looking through contracts with me, mm-hmm. He gets to just kind of hang out with my mom and, you know, sleep in and go grab donuts on the way to Daytona and sit in the stands and watch me for a few hours.
Yeah, that sounds like a pretty great thing to do, is to grab some donuts and watch racing at Daytona.
Oh yeah, we have a tradition at Daytona that, you know, have you been to Daytona?
No.
So there's a Krispy Kreme.
Oh, okay.
Maybe a mile away from the main entrance at Daytona, and my family loves Krispy Kreme. Really sure why, but when the hot light's on, it's physically, like it's a rule that if the hot light's on, you need to stop and get a dozen hot glazed donuts, no matter what. I need them to spot, I give them free advertising all the time. But whenever they're at Daytona, whenever I see them, I mean, I was at Daytona a couple months ago and they showed up for the race that day. You know, they flew in late at night. They left that day just to kind of come in and say hi and support me. And the first time I saw them, they each had like huge, like multiple huge boxes of hot Krispy Kreme donuts. That was their game plan, was show up, relax, kick back and eat like 20 donuts each.
That sounds like a good game plan. It's a good tradition to have.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's not so good if you're trying to be fit and a race car driver, but really good for them.
How does your mom feel about all of this? Because, you know, dads always want to do cool stuff.
Yeah.
With their kids, right? And then this is probably him being on cloud nine with what you're doing. He sounds like he's just so proud of you. How does your mom deal with this? And I say deal because that could be something to deal with, because there is so much danger involved in this sport. And yes, yep, it's getting more safe every single year, but you're still going at a very high rate of speed. And this is a sport, and this is a sport with potential to put you into serious, serious situations that could affect you for the rest of your life. So tell me about how your mom feels about this.
I think the standard trope is that dads are completely cool with racing and that moms are terrified of it and want to call Child Protective Services. That's definitely not my mom. The one thing I will say, though, is she's completely cool with my racing. She's into it. She's involved. She loves coming to the track, but she's never been right seat with me. Whenever I ask her to, she says, well, I just don't want to know. So I think right now we're operating really well because she just doesn't know and she doesn't have to know. I think that when she goes right seat with me, she might be kind of scared of what I'm actually doing for hours at a time.
Sure.
But she loves it. People at the track love her. My mom is hilarious. She steals my friends all the time because she's more fun to hang out with than me. And she has no filter and she walks around with food all the time. So it's impossible not to like her.
Yeah. Yeah.
But she comes to the track whenever she can. And my relationship with my mom as it pertains to racing has also been really interesting, because I think my dad's proud of what I've built from a complete racing standpoint. Like I think he's proud of the results that I've gotten and how much faster I've gotten. But I think my mom has watched me develop as kind of a contract writer and a negotiator. And I think that's what she's most proud of, is not necessarily me driving,
right, but
more me calling her and saying, hey, I'm trying to reword this NDA so it says X instead of Y. And by the way, I'm meeting with my sponsor. What do you think about me asking for this instead of this, or more of an in-kind sponsorship instead? And she always ends each one of those conversations with, this is so cool, I'm so proud of you, which is nice. But I think she's less involved in the actual racing stuff for me and more involved in the nitty-gritty aspect of, I call her for advice on contracts and things like that.
Okay. All right. So it sounds like it's a family business. You guys got, all your feet are wet at this point.
Kind of. Yeah. Oh, their feet are definitely very wet. I think that wasn't in their control at all. They're not involved in anything I do anymore. But I do call them and ask them for advice all the time, just because they actually aren't that involved in the racing world. You know, everyone else that I interact with, for the most part, like a lot of my friends are in the racing world. There are other racers, they're instructors, they're engineers, they're team owners, and they're all extremely entrenched in the world. And it's really helpful to get advice from my parents, because they're not that, they're third parties. So I can call them and say, well, what does this contract look like? And they can look past the like, oh, this brand is really cool, and say, well, no, you're undervaluing yourself and here's why. They think of it from a business standpoint and not from a racing standpoint, which is nice and a huge privilege for me. Like a lot of people don't have that to lean on, and I'm leaning on them less and less, but it is nice at the end of the day to have someone who can help you look over a contract instead of having to hire a lawyer. So
sure. Are they lawyers?
No, no. Okay. So really I should hire lawyers once in a while, actually. but no, they're smart, and they will occasionally, it's not that they catch things that I don't catch as much as they'll catch little nuances or interpret things differently. Or I'm usually the one coming up with the crazy big creative ideas, and they're the ones pulling me back to earth saying, well, no, you need to do this. And here are the step-by-step, the immediate like three steps that you need to take in the next 3 weeks to make it to this race and get this contract signed. Like stop thinking about the thing you're going to be doing in 2023.
Yeah, that's tough. That's tough, but it's also very smart. It's very smart for them to do that, because you could definitely get ahead of yourself, and you can definitely sabotage yourself by being a little too eager.
For sure. Well, and there are times where I've walked away from deals that I was initially very eager about, because they're right about whenever I get really excited about something, and I'm definitely more impulsive. I'm a very impulsive person. I like to just come up with ideas, then pull the plug on them no matter what it takes. Mm-hmm. And the good news is when I pull the plug on those things, I tend to do them. The bad news is I don't always, I need someone to kind of force me to pause a couple minutes before I pull the plug sometimes. And
what do you mean by that?
Actually part of the main way that Girls with Drive happened was me thinking, wow, I didn't have role models when I was younger. I was just thinking about this random afternoon. It's like, wouldn't it be nice to have a program that helps young girls get more involved in male dominated fields? Because there's so many resources out there for established women. Like if you are a 30-year-old woman interested in running for office. There are like three different foundations out there that can help you raise money, help connect you to other women, things like that. And there are foundations and kind of clubs for female engineers and women in business. But there's nothing to help the 13-year-old girl from, I mean, pick a random place, from the middle of Ohio that has parents that aren't as kind of business-minded as me. And she's thinking, wow, I really want to go into business and I want to go to school, but I don't know what scholarships to apply to or who to turn to. Mm-hmm. There aren't really any programs out there like that that take really young girls like that and nurture that initial seed of interest. All of the support out there right now is going towards women that have, or older girls that have essentially decided what they want to do already.
Sure.
So I want to take girls that are at risk of going into a different career path than business or engineering and say, no, come here. This is actually really interesting and let me connect you to internships and mentors and scholarship programs. And that happened in an afternoon. And by that night, I made a pitch deck, didn't really proofread it that much, sent it out to like 10 different companies and created the LLC. And that was not... On the one hand, you know, go me, I'm very proud of that. But on the other hand, I could have paused for a second, said like, well, what do I really want to do here? What's my 5-year plan? I'm going to school in a few months.
Mm.
What am I going to do about that?
So this is pre-college.
This was pre-college.
Wow.
I founded Girls With Drive before college, technically. I didn't really make a big deal about it until late last year and early this year because I realized I was being impulsive and my parents, correctly so, said, well, what's your vision here? And I said, well, I want to help young girls. I'm like, all right, good luck with that. You know, figure out exactly what you want to do and you're always better off with quality over quantity. Instead of having 500,000 girls kind of vaguely remember a program that they did when they were 8 years old, pick, you know, 100 girls that are itching to succeed in this category or have, you know, all of the intellectualism, the drive, but none of the resources, and change their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And that hit home for me, but that was a completely different business model than the one I built in 2 hours and sent out to 10 different companies. So,
sure. Yeah, well, there's that evolution. But I wanted to ask you, you said at risk. What do you mean by at risk?
Did I say that in terms of at-risk girls?
Yeah, you said at risk of going into a different career or going into, I don't know, maybe I'm misinterpreting it, but
no,
what did you mean by that?
Well, it was a weird phrase, but so most girls start to lose confidence in their own abilities by the time they're around 6 years old. And it obviously that's a soft statistic. It depends on kind of what you're talking about. But by 6 years old, girls are potentially noticing that fewer girls like math compared to them, or fewer girls want to go outside and wrestle around compared to, you know, all the guys. And that is a critical point, like early to late elementary school, when the foundations are created to not choosing higher level math courses. And when you don't choose that higher level math course in seventh grade, you're less likely to apply to engineering colleges in high school because you didn't take calculus.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you are in college, you're getting a liberal arts degree in art history, which is a perfectly fine major.
Yeah, for sure.
And then you
sure.
end up, yeah. And but then you end up in a career path that has a ton of women. And obviously I'm all for women and men, whoever you are, pursuing your passion. But there's a difference between pursuing something because you love it and pursuing something because you don't think you're capable of something else. I think a lot of young girls steer away from politics and business and engineering early on because they're scared that they aren't able to handle it. Or even worse, they think that they could handle it, but they don't see any other girls or women out there. And they think like, well, this is potentially a really rough path for me. You know, I'm going to be the only woman in the room for the next 10 years if I'm trying to get a master's in engineering.
Right.
And it's I think the point at which girls get turned away or turned off by those career paths isn't actually in college. Because if you're in college, you already have a pretty good idea of whether or not you like math. You pretty much know. I mean, you may be unsure of what exactly you want to go into long term, but you know, I'm a math person or I'm not a math person. Like, I want to go into the engineering school or I want to go into the liberal arts school.
Right.
So all of that transitioning happens much younger. It happens when you're 12 and under. And that's what I kind of refer to as at risk, where you have girls that are really interested. Like, I've watched so many girls come to the track and get really excited about racing or engineering, and they're actively engaged and they want to know what they can do that's different.
Mm-hmm.
And then you ask them what they're doing in school and they tend to be more bookish or they're interested in reading and they aren't as focused on physics or engineering or math, even though that's clearly what they want to do long term. And that's kind of what I'm trying to catch those girls at that critical point where they may not take that higher level math course or they may not apply to a college that has an economics program so they can get a business degree one day. Like I'm trying to take those girls that would otherwise go towards something that they may actually like less because it feels more achievable.
Sure. Sure. You're just trying to tap into people's potential.
Exactly. Well, and that's, I'm not trying to change anyone. I'm not trying to force girls right. to go into business who don't want to go into business.
Sure. You're giving them an opportunity.
Right. It's more about, you know, if you are interested in this, here's a list of resources. There are mentors that you can reach out to. Mm-hmm. And I exclusively go for very high profile mentors. Like one of my mentors for Girls with Drive is Zoe Berry, who is my boss last year. Mm-hmm. And she started her own company. She's in the digital health world or the kind of tech startup world. And she started it when she was in her, I think, mid-20s. And she's sole founder, sole CEO in a venture capital world where fewer than 3% of women entrepreneurs get funding. So she's in a super male-dominated field. Mm-hmm. And she's raised over $42 million in funding,
wow.
not counting the stuff that I'm not allowed to say yet. So she's doing really well. And the goal is to connect someone like that mm-hmm. with a 12-year-old girl who's thinking like, am I up to the challenge? Do I really want to do this? And Zoe can say, here are a list of scholarships that I applied to when I was in high school. Come tour my office. Come, you know, when you're 18, come intern for me for a year. Be my personal associate. I can take you into board meetings and you can learn what it's like to stand up in front of a group of men and hold your own. Mm-hmm. I think if you give young, driven, intellectual girls resources that they wouldn't otherwise have, that's all you really need to do. You don't need to push them to do anything.
Sure.
You just need to give them the tools.
All you're trying to do is you're trying to get the confidence at the forefront with these girls,
yeah.
with these women. As a teenager, that's such a pivotal time in building that confidence. And teenagers are brutal.
Yeah.
Did you experience any harshness from anyone your age?
My roommate from last year explained it to me best. She said, racing is such an extraordinary experience and that doesn't make it crazy. You know, she wasn't saying like, oh, you're famous or you're better than everyone or you can be condescending because of racing. She was saying it's just very different. And I started racing when I was 13. So I essentially grew up, like a lot of my formative teenage years were with groups of guys in their early 20s. So I started interacting best with groups of guys in their early 20s. And those are most of my best friends now. And by the time I was 15 and I was a young girl going into high school, I realized I was just super socially awkward with other girls and other kids my age. And my roommate basically said, don't overthink it. It's just because that's how you've been raised. You've never actually had to interact with kids your age. You've always been interacting with older people. And when they encounter someone that is part of such a different world and has had such different life experience than them, not better or worse, just different, they may not necessarily know how to handle it. Because a lot of the responses I got from friends when I was leaving for races, it wasn't necessarily like they were in awe or they were excited about it. They just, a lot of them actually in high school would respond with, oh, or, you know, okay, well, have fun. They wouldn't really know how to kind of mentally handle the fact that I was leaving high school for weeks at a time for this.
Sure. Yeah. It's not a very common thing, racing.
It's not common at all. And the other thing is when you get serious enough in the racing world, you usually drop out of school or you're homeschooled. Mm-hmm. So it's also really weird from a racing standpoint for me to have to say, well, no, I'm taking an earlier flight out because I need to make it to my Spanish test.
Sure.
So it went both ways, but all in all, I'm really lucky right now in the sense that I'm at Harvard and I've found a group of friends that, you know, incidentally, a lot of them also have professional careers outside of racing or outside of school, sorry. Mm-hmm. A lot of them have careers outside of school and they are interested in racing, but they don't necessarily perceive it as weird or off or different or strange. It's just kind of this cool side gig that I have that doesn't make me any different. It doesn't make me any cooler or scarier. It just is my job. It's my day job. And then I come back to Boston whenever I can and I take classes when I can and then I leave.
But it does make you different.
Yeah, it makes me very different. The weirdest thing that I've had to come to terms with is like, I have I have girlfriends, like I have female friends now that I'm in college for the first time in years because I took time off of school. I took a year off and I was working in the tech world, which is probably almost as male dominated as racing.
Probably.
So yeah. I was surrounded by a lot of guys all the time. And I was also racing full time last year when I wasn't in school. So all of my friends for the most part were men. So I'm also kind of learning how to deal with that. Like having female friends is just really different from having male friends. Mm-hmm. And I've grown up in this very macho culture. You know, racing is very male. It's very, you don't care about getting hurt and there's fire and rubber everywhere and you're dirty all the time. I've gotten really used to that. I've gotten used to wrestling my friends and kind of being a little rough. And then I go back to school and it's just not quite like that. So yeah.
There have been multiple studies that have shown that it's actually physically impossible for us to multitask. So how are you able to be a full-time racing driver? And yes, you took some time off of school.
Yeah.
But you did get into Harvard, which is no easy feat. How are you able to get all of this done and still hone your skill to become a professional racing driver?
I think you said it best, which is multitasking is no easy feat. Yes, I have all of these different things going on, but my biggest goal, and it is something I struggle with, is to kind of separate and compartmentalize as much as possible. Not in a bad way. You know, what I do at school feeds into my racing. I am constantly learning a lot about business in school. That directly translates and vice versa. You learn things about just life management in general and sure. relationship management in racing that goes back to life and school. That being said, I do a lot of schoolwork on planes. You can't get on conference calls on planes. It's actually a really good time to put your phone and your computer on airplane mode and turn off your Wi-Fi. And it's like, all right, I have a 6-hour flight from Boston to LA and I am not going to do anything other than grab a cup of coffee from the cart and just work. I'm just going to read as much as I can or get this essay out as quickly as I can. And if you set time limits for yourself like that, where you're actually focused, I think most people would be surprised at how efficient they can be, but you have to really be focused. Every time you look at Facebook, you're starting from the bottom.
Yeah.
So that's kind of my biggest goal for myself. And I'm not always good at it. You know, there have been times where I have my Wi-Fi on the plane and I hear my email pinging and I know that it's something racing related. I'm like, oh, well, I can respond to this one email from my sponsor and then just get back to what I was doing. But it doesn't work like that. You know, if I start to answer emails, I'll be on emails for 3 hours.
Yeah, you're in that rabbit hole for
exactly.
a while.
Exactly. So I've been trying very hard to focus myself when I need to on specific things. Mm-hmm. And the same thing's true about racing, kind of on steroids. You know, school requires a certain amount of focus. And I think that's true anywhere. You know, if you have to do schoolwork, you have to do schoolwork. But racing is a completely different level. And yes, Harvard is a lot of work. But racing is, if you aren't 100% focused on driving and being prepared and strapping into the car and making sure you have everything you need, the stakes aren't, well, I'm going to take my test a day late or I'm going to fail that class. The stakes are you're going to crash a race car that's worth $300,000 and you may very well hurt yourself and others in the process.
Yep.
So that is much easier for me because I really feel that. So whenever I get to the track for a race weekend, my rule is other than really imminent things like, well, my Girl Scouts are coming to the track and I need to make sure I have a place for them to stay or I need snacks for them. Other than those tiny little jobs, and that's where it gets really helpful to drag my parents along to the track when they're willing.
Sure.
But other than that, I'm just focused on driving. And that's a hard line for me. Like I will not respond to emails. I won't respond to things that are school related at the risk of potentially hurting my school experience, because once I respond to one, I might be thinking about that email or that test in the back of my mind when I get into the car. And that's not just inefficient, it's dangerous.
You have this thing that you're working on,
Yep.
I mean, we're getting to the point where we're getting an understanding of what you are and what drives you and how passionate you are about this thing. So what next? I mean, you're at Harvard, you're studying, you're driving, and you've got this Girls with Drive thing. Where is the focus going to be in the next 5, 10, 15 years?
So, I mean, the short answer is God knows. I mean, that's the danger of being impulsive is you start a bunch of things and you say, oh, well, I could do any of these. I think I am an unconventional race car driver, not because I'm a girl, but because I kind of see an endpoint for myself. And I've always been very straight up about this to media and to sponsors that I love racing. Mm-hmm. I think it's a dream to think that I could ever mentally handle quitting. I think that I'd give it maybe a year before I'd freak out and try to get back into a car. That being said, I am much more focused on girls with drive long term. Okay. I mean, I can also say that because I have the privilege of having sponsors that want to continue to support me and have multi-year contracts with me. So I can do things like come up with a 5-year racing plan and not really think about it too much. Mm-hmm. But girls with drive, I think, has more potential. And, you know, it's racing is amazing, but at the end of the day, you're going around in circles, right? Like the net displacement is quite literally zero. You're starting in the same place and you're ending in the same place. And it's fun and it's interesting and it creates amazing platforms and you meet amazing people, but you're still driving around in circles at the end of the day. And why do that my entire life when I can use that platform to build something bigger out of it? That's my coach years ago said something about like, why would you race cars when you can build a wing on a hospital? And it's a little melodramatic, but I also think it's true.
It's very true.
You have this media following and you have this program and you have sponsorships and you have companies that actively want to work with you. And why would I turn that into 5 years of, you know, just 5 years of like, okay, I'm going to race in Europe and give myself a huge salary and like live the good life and, you know, travel around in business class. And then at the end of the day, what do you really have out of that? You have a bunch of really cool Instagram photos and that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
Versus if I can save that money and try to push companies towards Girls with Drive and take economy flights to Girls with Drive programs instead of, you know, pulling it all back to myself. Long term, I would like to not actually be racing, but I'd like to have a program through Girls with Drive that is helping hundreds of thousands of girls all the time. I'd like it. I mean, this is very long term, but I'd love to create a grant program through Girls with Drive. So if I have a young girl that's applying to an economics program somewhere and she doesn't have the financial means and she's done everything she can to raise scholarship money, maybe I can give her a grant for 4 years for college or things like that. Mm-hmm. Again, that's a really kind of long term deal, but that's where I see myself going, if anything. The other thing is I want to be very realistic about what I am actually capable of. We said this earlier, but like you need to keep your feet on solid ground in terms of what you can actually do. And yes, this is my nonprofit. I started it, I run it, but I'm also 20 and I'm also still going to school and I do still want to race. Like I think it's a pipe dream to think that I'm ever going to quit racing and be happy because unfortunately it's addicting. You fall down the rabbit hole and that's kind of it. Like even if I quit pro racing, I'm going to end up somewhere in a spec Miata for the rest of my life. So given that, I would love to build out Girls with Drive over the next couple years and then hand it off to someone who's more capable. And there is someone out there, you know, there's some really intelligent, driven woman who wants to go into the nonprofit world and build up this program who has decades of experience and is more qualified than me. And that doesn't mean I'm not the right person for the job right now. But if I do my job right and I grow Girls with Drive well enough, ideally, the job should actually outgrow me. You know, that's if I'm doing a good job at building my own company, eventually it should be bigger than me. So that's my biggest goal over the next few years, actually, is get Girls with Drive to the point where it can't be me, where it has to be a really amazing scaled program that includes thousands of women and thousands of girls every year, and become something where I can look back, you know, in 2030 and see a bunch of girls that came to my Girl Scout program in 2019 and are now working in the top administrative spots at BMW.
So here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to take this opportunity to let people know where they can find you and your cause.
Okay.
Because I think it's really important. I think you've got a really good thing going here. So Cool. Shoot.
So you can find information about me and where I'll be racing on any of my social media or my website. So just at Aurora Straus for everything, for Instagram, Facebook, what have you. And you can find more information on Girls with Drive on my website that will be published by the time this episode comes out.
Okay.
It's girlswithdrive.org. I'm not soliciting donations right now, but I am soliciting contact information. So if you want to learn more about Girls with Drive, or if you are a young girl and you would like connections to the mentors that I have spoken about in this episode, click on the little join us button And you can go directly, any contact information that you send over will go directly to my email. So solicit me and I will respond.
Great. Well, yeah. I want to thank you for this opportunity to sit down with you. I'm very impressed.
Thank you.
And I enjoyed this thoroughly. It was great to hear your passion come through this microphone. So thank you very much for driving out here and for sitting down with me and for telling me your story.
Yeah, thank you guys. Thank you, Frank. Thank you for having a really adorable dog that wants to sit in my lap.
It
occurred to me when I was walking in here that if I just say, oh, Frank, the CEO of Road Stories is sitting on my lap right now, I would have to clarify that. So
the Road Stories podcast is recorded and edited by me, Michael Sendorovich. If you like the show, please leave me a review wherever you listen. It helps the show greatly. And finally, please follow me on Instagram at Road Stories Mike. Thanks so much for listening.